Hey guys, Philosopher here, and today I'm debuting the July Stockwatch infographic. So the purpose of this infographic, which is linked below in the description, is to look at the changes in the game from an end game perspective in terms of how the characters' value are going up and down, how the new characters coming into the game shifts the meta, that sort of thing. And you may think to yourself, well, hey, I'm not an end game player. I'm not a whale. I'm just starting out, or I'm a mid-game player. You can still benefit from this infographic as well. And actually, the purpose here is actually to help players plan around what Scopely's doing, okay? Because Scopely actually tries to limit the information we have about the game. Why? Well, they want us to have bottlenecks. They want us not to be able to plan ahead. They want us to invest in the wrong characters so that this way we have bottlenecks and end up spending money on their offers. And the way around that is to plan ahead, understand what's happening in the game so that this way you can invest your resources properly. Okay, so let's get right to the first one here. And the first trending up character on this list is Moondragon. So Moondragon is a really interesting character. She's actually a fantastic raid character. However, her cooldowns are just too long. So if you look at her ultimate, it's a fantastic ability. 30% healing for all allies. Defense down for 2 turns to all enemies, but 6-turn cooldown. On the special, also 30% healing. Defense up, deflect. Amazing, right? Ability, clearing positive effects from all enemies, but it's a 5-turn cooldown. She reminds me a lot of Ebony Maw, who when he was released was a fantastic raid character, but his alt was 7 turns, his special was 5-turn cooldown, and so he was always paired with Thanos to feed him energy. And until now, Moondragon had no one who could feed her energy. However, Captain Sam is coming to the game. If you look at his special, every third turn, he is granting ability energy to other allies, particularly to random skill allies, 2 to 3 energy there. So that is fantastic. She can, I think, count on a regular basis getting this energy from Captain Sam. So I think that makes Moondragon a more viable character for the moon, Doom Raid and beyond. Okay, guys, so let's go now to the second one on the list, and that is the Shield Avenger. So, you know, it's interesting here. I think one thing that Maria Hill provides that is helpful is a cleanse. So if you look here at Shield Care Package, this is going to clear all negative effects from self, Avenger, and skill allies. She's also a member of S.H.I.E.L.D., and, you know, if you look at the S.H.I.E.L.D. team, one of the weaknesses of this team is it doesn't have a cleanse. The only S.H.I.E.L.D. member who could cleanse is Black Widow, and by the way, Black Widow only cleanses Avenger and skill military allies. So, you know, a lot of these other characters like S.H.I.E.L.D. Medic or S.H.I.E.L.D. Security or and so forth are not, you know, are not Avengers. They're not going to get cleansed. Maria Hill can be put in that team to do that. Now, I know a lot of you are probably thinking, well, I don't use S.H.I.E.L.D. on defense. You know, it is a team that is used in like Platinum 1 and Gold 4. So for mid-game players who are using this team, I think that Maria Hill will help them. She's also going to help people who want to use Wave 1 Avengers and, you know, have invested heavily in that team and want to rely on it in war defense. You know, this was a very strong war defense for a long time. But now that Black Widow is in Skillitary, it has really hurt the value of this team, in part because they don't have the cleanse from Black Widow. Now they will have that cleanse from Maria Hill if you want to throw Maria Hill in this team, because she cleanses all the other Avengers. I don't necessarily think this is the best use of Maria Hill, by the way. I think that it's very possible that you want to keep all the Secret Avengers together and use them with, let's say, Kestrel and Fury or something. Time will tell. But I do think that particularly for beginning and mid-level players, like I said, this infographic's trying to help everyone. I think she offers some flexibility there. She's also, it's one thing that's important to note, is that Maria Hill does, as I said, she has the S.H.I.E.L.D. tag, and all of the Secret Avengers have the Avenger tag. And so that does mean for Gamma, she is going to help you in those middle lanes. And then the Avengers are going to help on the side lanes in the early nodes. So I think that's something also to keep in mind. These characters do help in some ways that you might not expect. And that moves us to another character who's going to help in the Gamma raid, and that is Phi Lavelle. So, you know, if you, I've been on the side of the side lanes in Gamma for quite some time, and there are slim pickings over there. And if difficulty three can actually be pretty tough. So if you look, for example, it's the tag on the very left lane is Kree slash Pym. Looking at the Kree characters, you can see without Phi Lavelle, it's just basically Minerva, Captain Marvel. I mean, some people do use Ultimus or Ronin if they've overbuilt the character, but those characters are totally out of the meta, and I wouldn't recommend building them right now. So Phi Lavelle's a, you know, high meta, super OP character who can, you know, definitely add some value there. And, you know, frankly, right now on that second boss node of Gamma 4.3 is one of the hardest raid nodes in the game. And what people have been doing now to deal with that is they've been, you know, building up not only ghosts, but characters like Stature and Yellowjacket and so forth. And this will make that less necessary, or at least I hope. All right. So then let's look at what's trending down. And I think that the top choice is pretty obvious. You know, Heroes for Hire. You know, this is a team when it first came out. You know, I certainly invested in the team. But as I said at the time, I really recommended that unless you're a super endgame player who's been done with DD4 for many months and is focused on Alliance War, that this is a team you should probably just put your spare gear into at best, because, you know, these war defense teams are always countered within a few months. What I didn't expect is that literally the counter would come 1 month later. I think that did not feel good for some people who invested super heavily into Heroes for Hire. They're obviously trending down because, you know, just a month ago, the entire, all of Alliance War centered around Heroes for Hire, and they were unbeatable other than with sort of a super team carefully and specifically constructed to beat them. You know, people were using stuff like Surfer and Kestrel and Black Bolt and Emma and so forth. Well, now they could just be beaten straight up by Infinity Watch. That said, this team does not overreact. This team is still very strong. And in fact, Infinity Watch and Heroes for Hire are kind of on a tier on their own. And, you know, now the meta in Alliance War is very much focused around, well, how many Infinity Watches are on defense? And so, you know, if they're on defense, you've got to use your Infinity Watch in the mirror match. And then you have to use those old counters in Heroes for Hire. If not, you can use your Infinity Watch against Heroes for Hire. So the Heroes for Hire are still part of the equation, and they're still very important. But they're certainly trending down, no question about that. You know, another character that's also obviously trending down, but we shouldn't be overreacting to how much he's trending down, is Red Guardian. So, you know, up until now, Red Guardian is basically a required character, almost the first character I would recommend getting up after Kestrel for the skill nodes in the Doom Raid. However, you know, Captain Sam, I think, is clearly a better protector. So, you know, if you were starting your, you know, starting today and you had a 7-star Captain Sam and a 7-star Red Guardian and we're just starting Doom Raids, I would suggest gearing up and ISOing up, more importantly, Captain Sam first. However, that said, first of all, Captain Sam is a strike pass character, and it's unclear how we're going to be able to get our hands on him and if people are going to have him at high stars, right? If you have a two-star Captain Sam, you're better off with a 7-star Red Guardian who you can just farm up through the arena store. In addition, you know, Red Guardian, putting aside that, even if you had the high stars and red stars in your Captain Sam, you know, Red Guardian is going to have value for a long time. And so don't underestimate Red Guardian. Don't overstate how much he's declining, because look, Red Guardian, first of all, he is part of an important war offense team. Separate and apart from that, Red Guardian, you know, spawns with taunt. He also spawns with defense up. And, you know, so he is actually better than the previous pre-taunting character, Drax. And you know what? I still use Drax in Alliance War. You know, people use him on defense and on offense whenever you want to make sure that the enemy has to focus on Drax instead of one of your more important characters first. So what I would just say is that, you know, Red Guardian is a plug-and-play character that even if Skeletary falls out of the meta, is going to have value in war and elsewhere, frankly, in raids and, you know, Greek raids and, you know, in other raids for a long time. So don't be upset about an investment in Red Guardian at all, but just be aware of the fact that certainly his value has gone down a little bit due to the Captain Sam being introduced to the game. And then on a similar vein, Taskmaster and Zemo are still fantastic characters. They're not bad characters or anything, but their value's gone down. More, I'd say, than Red Guardian. Because so for Taskmaster and Zemo, 3 months ago, if you were gearing up for the Doom Raid, you basically needed those characters just to survive in the skill nodes. It was all about control, and you did, because we just did not have the damage to get through those skill nodes. So it was all about trying to control the enemies so that you could use your little Nerf bats. You know, you're almost like going at the enemies with Nerf bats or squirt guns or something to try to whittle them down over time. Well, once Kestrel came out, you know, Taskmaster and Zemo were not necessary in the first node. They were not necessary on the boss node. And they just became sort of necessary on the second node, where you have Strange and X-23 and Negasonic and all these characters, an enemy Taskmaster, are all throwing out a lot of damage and debuffs right away early on. And I've got to say that, you know, they aren't 100% necessary in those nodes, but they are the best team for that node. And I, because I know I'm going to get comments and, you know, messages from all these players like, well, I don't use those characters. I use these other characters. You know, particularly in base difficulty, it's a lot easier, but particularly as you get to difficulty one, it's clear to me that those are, you know, having that control is really helpful and important on the second node. But now Sharon Carter is going to come in, and she does stun and ability block, and she's got power creep stats, and she's part of a great raid team. So I really think that you will be able to drop at least one of those two, maybe both. And so, you know, if you were starting today to gear up just for Doom Raid, focus on Doom Raid only, you know, you may not be gearing up both of those characters. You'll probably be gearing up Sharon Carter at one of those at the most. And particularly because Taskmaster's war defense team has gone down in value recently due to the Skeletary counter. And then Baron Zemo is no longer part of the arena meta. So I think those characters have gone down in value. They're still very good. I'm sure I'll hear from people who love Baron Zemo and all that. He's a great character, and I'm glad he's farmable for new players. But these definitely their value has gone down. All right, let's talk about the new characters for a minute. You know, as I've said elsewhere, Secret Avengers are kind of the answer to a problem we didn't have. So, you know, I think 4 or 5 months ago, we were all crying to Scopely about how awful the skill section of the Doom Raid was, how we needed help. But ever since Kestrel's come, that section's been pretty easy. So you don't really need a skill raiding team, at least right now. You don't need a new team. That said, you know, first of all, Secret Avengers are going to be helpful, I'm sure, in the Doom 2 raid and I'm sure for Doom 1, there's going to be difficulties 2, 3, and 4, or whatever they're going to come out in the future. And then also, obviously, these characters are going to be useful elsewhere, as I mentioned, not only in the Gamma raid where, you know, Maria Hill's got the shield tag, but also you also are going to have uses for them in war and elsewhere. So I do think these are strong characters and they're good, but are they super necessary? Like can't miss them kind of characters? Probably not. But I do want to talk a little bit about Captain Sam, because people have asked me, are these characters viable elsewhere? And they all may have uses elsewhere. I wouldn't be surprised. And we've talked a little bit about Maria Hills, but Captain Sam, I really think, has the most plug and play value in the team. And it's just because when you look at the abilities that he has, as we already talked about, his special gives the ability energy, which always energy batteries, I think, have had a lot of life in this game for the, you know, just because there's value in giving ability energy to better characters, newer characters, etc. Plus, he also gives speed bar to skill allies. So, and he does both of those on a reasonably low cooldown. So, you know, when you have a character that survives very well, he's got OP power creep stats, and he gives ability energy and speed bar to others. I just think that's a character you can use on a lot of different teams. All right, so let's go now to pretty much the number one question I've gotten this month. I have, every time I stream and on my Discord, which is linked below as always, I'm constantly getting questions. And the people ask the same questions over and over. And big one is, should I take Gamora to Red Star, six Red Stars or seven Red Stars? Or should I promote Gamora or Kestrel? Well, I did a video on the subject, so you could just watch the entire video where I discuss this in detail. But the bottom line is, you know, for the long run, I think Kestrel and Silver Surfer are going to have more value than Gamora, because Gamora is more or less a ball of stats. In other words, Gamora right now is the number one damager on the number one team, and so that's very exciting, okay? But if you've been playing this game for even 3, 4, 5 months, you'll remember that we were all very excited about White Tiger, right, who had a lot of damage in the Best War team, or we were very excited about Colleen Wing and super damage, and, you know, there's always a new damager that comes out over time. That is super great, okay? And the issue, of course, is that it's all based on their stats, and then once some new character comes out with even higher stats, then they're no longer the top dog, right? There was a time when Black Bolt was by far the highest damage in the game. So, you know, Gamora's time is here, and she's certainly worth the investment. Putting your gold promos on a character that is the high, you know, the you know, an important part or key, the, you know, a key part of the best team is not a bad idea. But for the long run, I do think that Kestrel's kit, where she prevents cloning and summons and doesn't allow you to revive on her ultimate, and, you know, for example, cleanses her own debuffs and heals and all that, you know, and does that out-of-turn attack. I mean, there's just a lot there to love. She's, you know, in my opinion, the best character in the game right now. I think she's going to hold value extremely well. Similarly with Silver Surfer, I mean, that's a character who is the only character in the game who removes charges, and he takes all these turns, and he, you know, heals him, you know, he heals himself, and he's got pretty much, in my opinion, the best basic in the game, where he takes all the debuffs on him and throws them on the enemy, or takes all of their buffs and puts them on himself. I mean, just very powerful character in terms of the kit. So, you know, I think those characters are very safe, but Gamora is also fantastic. So I think those three are the ones that I put gold promos on. And gold promotion credits are pretty much the rarest currency in the game. So there's very few people who are like, oh, I've got 800 gold promos, so I can just do, you know, upgrade all these characters. You know, for most people, it's like, okay, I got 100 gold promos, who do I use them on, right? So, I've kind of walked through these three characters. I think it depends on who you use most or who you're getting the most value from. You know, for me, my Infinity Watch team kind of steamrolls everyone anyway. And I'm really doing fine with Kestrel. So I don't feel an intense need to blow all my gold promos, but I'll use some of them. And I have used already gold promos to bring up Kestrel and Surfer to six. One thing I want to keep in mind, though, is that we have more characters on the way. So right now, you cannot promote Phyla Vell. You cannot promote Adam Warlock. So I'm sure that I'm going to get comments from people who didn't listen this far into the video, and they're going to say, on your list of Red Star upgrades, where's Phyla Vell? Where's Adam Warlock? Where's Moondragon, right? they're not promotable yet. And there's going to be other characters coming out, whether it's Captain Sam or Sharon Carter or Maria Hill or Shang-Chi or some other character. So there's always new characters coming out. So be thoughtful about spending the gold promos. As for the silver promos, I think you can use them on any of these characters, and you know, they come much more freely, so that's totally fine. But there's definitely a drop off after the first few. So Kestrel, Surfer, Gamora, I think, are kind of on their own tier. They're worth gold promos. You know, Bishop and Nebula, I mean, my thought process here is just that Bishop is the damager and the tank for a raid team that we know will stick around for the mutant nodes for some time. And then Nebula, you know, she's part of the top team and the only member of the top team that you can upgrade other than Gamora right now. So she's kind of here because I think taking her to 5 stars, assuming you've got, you know, it all depends on the state of your roster. There's no right or wrong answer. But if you've got, you know, most of your characters up to 4 or 5 stars and you've got a bunch of silver promo credits, I don't have any problem with you promoting Nebula. The rest of these characters, though, are clear tier below those. I mean, Baron Zemo, we've already talked about, you know, his value's gone down. Still a fantastic all-around character, but not what he was a couple months ago. Symbiote Spider-Man and Anti-Venom I have in here just because the bio nodes are really the hardest section of difficulty one now, because the symbiotes are pretty power crept. But I do think that when you have a a bio character or two that gets added, I think to the extent the symbiotes ever get hybridized, the symbiote Spider-Man and Anti-Venom will be the characters that survive that hybridization. They'll be the two that are left standing. So unless a whole new team's enters the game, I think those two are worth getting up, and you're going to need them in the meantime. Doc Ock, I think, is a safe investment for Tech, just because, you know, he's got a very good kit in terms of the summon and the healing and flip and all of that, the prevention of offense down. So he's, I think, a safe bet. And the long shot is just a very good character who benefits heavily from Red Stars. And so given that, I think, that team is a team that I think will retain value. And then as a fifth character gets added eventually, I think we'll have a resurgence. So, I also wouldn't feel bad about somebody, bringing him up to four or five Red Stars. But that's about it. It was pretty slim pickings after the top tier. And it just shows you how much the meta changes in this game. If you're complaining about how I'm always focused on these new characters, blame Scopely, not me, because Scopely just keeps introducing OP characters that really bring the rest of them down a notch, the older characters. All right, let's look forward. The first two I've had on here for a while, farming ISO, bringing characters up to ISO 5 for the Doom Raid and for the rewards that we have now. To me, that's a no-brainer. I mean, the Doom Raid gets you blue ISO, gets you Surfer Shards. The new challenge rewards are tons of free gear. So, to me, that should be the focus of most people right now. If you don't have a lot of characters at ISO 5 and aren't farming the Doom Raid, very consistently, that should be what you're working towards. I also think, similarly, Doom Raid has to be a goal. I mean, these two things go hand in hand, but, there's an element of just gearing up as opposed to just ISO 5. In other words, not only do you need to worry about ISO, but you have to make sure your characters are G15, really. I would recommend for Doom Raid, you can get away with G14 characters, certain characters like Red Guardian. You can even have a gear tier 13, but generally you want to get your characters geared up for the Doom Raid as well. So those, I think, are the most important goal. But then one thing that's new this month that I really want everyone to be thinking about is that I think in the next 2 to 3 months, we're going to have some very significant changes to the game. And part of that's from the data mine. We've seen that Doom Raid 2 is already in the game files, and the reward is red gear. And we also know from a recent blog post that the dev said that there's going to be a level cap increase in the not too distant future, which generally tells you there's going to be a new gear tier as well. And I will also say that Dark Dimension usually comes every 10 or 11 months. And, I was racing in Dark Dimension last December. Okay. So, we're getting to the point now where I wouldn't be surprised of, them introducing, let's say, a level cap increase and new gear and a new raid within the next month or two, with Dark Dimension 5 to follow right thereafter. So it's just something to keep in mind. I think that what this tells me is, to the extent that you care about getting an early start on that stuff, you should be thinking ahead to storing up your gear and your gold and orbs and all that stuff now. All right, guys, if you like this video, smash that like button, subscribe to this channel. If you got feedback, discussion, questions, leave them below in the comments, or just go to my Discord. We have lots of great discussions there. That is linked in the description below. And also, my Twitch stream is also linked in the description below, and I stream most weeknights.